Welcome back to Proactive, where I'm talking to Mo Kahn now. He's the chief executive at hVIVO, and some more good news today, Mo. It's another full service human challenge contract with a top five global pharma company. You must be delighted.
I am. Thank you for having me on, Tom. Towards the end of the year, Merry Christmas to you and all your viewers. So very pleased to announce this significant size contract for hVIVO. This is a full service contract, so it involves all the normal services that you expect that we offer. The one difference here really is that this is for an RSV challenge strain that we currently have active, and it includes a manufacturing step. It also includes a small dosing step just to confirm that the infectivity rate is the right level, then running into a full service human challenge trial in 2024-25. So the work will start immediately, but the majority of the revenue will be recognized in 2024 and some going into 2025. So yes, overall, very pleased that we're continuing to work on RSV. I mean, this challenge agent, by the way, has been very significant in the development of hVIVO as a CRO, because a number of our clients have been able to obtain fast track designation through their work on this challenge strain. In fact, one client got all the way to getting marketing authorization for an RSV vaccine after they had conducted a challenge trial with this strain. So I'm very pleased to say that we will continue to work on the RSV Memphis strain as a challenge strain as we move into the future.
Thank you, Mo. So the fact that it is a multi-cohort trial rather than the usual drug versus placebo, is that a significant thing for those people like me who aren't up to date with all the terms?
Well, yes, it's a significant progress with regards to the challenge trial concept and what the customers are wanting to get from it. So historically, as you may know, the key endpoints for challenge trial was to basically determine whether the drug has an efficacy or an effectiveness signal. So you basically had two arms in the trial. One group of patients received a placebo, and the second group received an active. And by the end of the study, you hope to see whether the drug is effective or not. But now more and more of our clients are looking to check additional data and make kind of more data-driven decisions as they move forward into phase three. So, for example, this client is looking not only to see whether their drug works in a challenge trial, but also at what dose. So they're using more than one dose to see which dose is the optimum for phase three stage. Secondly, the second variable in this is they're also using what's called a triggered dosing concept, whereby you wait for a patient to become infected, and then you wait maybe 2, 3, or 4 days before you dose them. And the idea behind that is to try and mimic what happened in the field. So as you know, when you have cold or flu symptoms and you go and see your GP, it's already been 3 or 4 days since you became exposed to a virus or a pathogen. So try and replicate that environment in a human challenge trial study means that our clients are not only able to make a de-risking decision for the phase three, but also optimize the design for the late clinical stage programs.
So from what you're saying, it sounds like you imagine that this is a little bit of a trend, something we're going to be seeing more of in the future.
Absolutely. I mean, you've seen this already, to be honest, because our contract size have grown recently. And the key driver for that is that the number of healthy volunteers we need to recruit is increasing. And what's behind that, of course, is that there are more and more different arms in which we have to recruit into. So not only to determine whether the drug works, but also to see what dose it works at, you know, when to dose the individual patient, what endpoint to select. So yeah, to your point, we will see more and more new ways of the use of human clinical challenge trial data to de-risk and optimize late-stage clinical development.
Just one final thing from me, Mo. You did mention in the RNS that you believe yourselves to be trading ahead of expectations. Now, you will be limited, obviously, in what you can say about that, but is there anything you could just reveal for us before we get the full update in January?
Yeah, absolutely. So as we come towards the end of the year, of course, we are much more confident in our financials for this current year. So yeah, I'm very pleased to say that we are currently trading slightly ahead of revenue, but we also expect our EBITDA margins to be exceeding 20%. And that's also ahead of the guidance we had previously published. But as you mentioned, we will be giving a much more thorough update in January of next year. But all in all, a wonderful year for the company. We've done really well in the delivery of the work we've had, as well as managing the right EBITDA margins as we move forward.
Let me wish you a very Merry Christmas in that case, Mo. And thank you very much indeed for your time today.
Thank you very much, Tom. Take care.